Welcome back, everybody, here to your wonderful broadcast from our wonderful new studio. I say new studio. It's actually our old one. We basically played doctors and went chop, 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 and then... Yeah. It's perfect.
It's cozy in here, though.
It really is. It's about half the size of our last one, but it's the perfect size for what we're doing here in the studio. Let's go to the game, peoples, because we are here for our final game. I realize I might be a little bit too quiet there, too, for everyone at home. But yes, we are here to do... our matchup right now, WDL, U5. Now, normally we would say, you know what, Cap, I know these guys. These guys are classic. We've known these guys since the dawn of time. Like, it's they've been around for a long time. We know exactly where they've come from, where they're going to, and all that kind of jazz. But through very thick and thorough research, we have found Jackal.
Nothing. Absolutely yep. Nothing. I think I can call myself the Western expert on U5 because I've casted two games of theirs so far, which are the only two official matches they have.
That's huge cap.
But yeah, they're new upcoming squad. I think they've got a lot of talent. That's always rife in the Chinese scene. I keep talking about it every single time I cast one of these games and you have one of the amateur teams, but it's always the Chinese scene just does not give enough room for the amateur teams to shine. And so when you bring on somebody like this,
10 seconds,
they oftentimes create a splash. And I think they have a good chance of taking down Dreamtime. Now, their first matchup was up against Hong Fu, and it was close. And I was going, okay, but these are the two bottom teams. But Tong Fu completely surprised me. They beat Dreamtime. I know you early were casting them up against Newbie. They put up a good fight against Newbie.
Yeah,
so Tong Fu, I mean, they're looking great. So the fact that U5 had a strong match against them actually makes me pretty confident. I think they can take down Dreamtime.
Really?
I think so.
I'm going to reserve my judgment until I see the draft come through, mm-hmm. but as you are the expert on U5,
two whole games.
I will bend to your knowledge.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, man, for me, Dreamtime, like, these were guys which I think disappointed everyone during the Chinese qualifiers.
Yes.
Everyone expected them to do really, really well and be the other team, not CIS, that actually got through. But yeah.
Radiant
well, poor Super won't be going to another.
Yeah, I didn't believe myself. Toby, I don't know if you knew this. Of course, you were in Sweden at the time, but I actually had a betting. I was betting with Rio Burros. We were betting on the top two for each qualifier.
Oh, really?
Yes. So I got the first one. I got the American qualifier. We both thought that Scythe were going to make it in the Southeast Radiant Asian qualifier.
Oh, didn't you just get snapped back on that one?
So we both got taken out of that one, so there was no money.
Okay, you actually thought Scythe was going to take number one?
No. We just bet it on the top two in general.
Okay, so, all right. But Arrow was in your list, right?
Yeah, it was Arrow and Scythe. No. Arrow and Scythe was Rio Burrows. That was his bet.
Okay.
Because I didn't want to be the same as him, I went for Scythe and, I believe, Mythrust. Were my reserve 1-2. That was like my crazy bet,
That
was my way out there bet.
Yeah, that's like hopes in Laquelle's morphling.
I know. It was
may the tsunami hit again kind of thing.
It was just mainly just me not wanting to bet the same as Ryu, because if we bet the same, then we just cancel out the bet.
Yeah.
But going into the Chinese qualifier, oh man, we both bet on LGD and Dreamtime. And I was like, do I change my bet and bet on CIS? And I almost did it. I was so close to doing it. I was like, how much do I believe in black? How much do I believe in black? And I didn't do it. And I didn't do it. And it just killed me later that CIS did take that second place. And I was like, no! I could add 40 bucks rather than just 20.
I'm surprised a fisherman's bet has meant that much to you, Cap.
Well, it did. It was a sense of pride knowing the teams and it, you know, just being able to call who's going to make it. The money doesn't mean much.
No. There was no money, so obviously it wouldn't mean
anything. No, I won 20 bucks off of Ryu.
Oh, really?
He has to pay me 20 bucks.
Yeah. So at TI4, he'll be paying?
Yes. He'll be buying me lunch.
Really? It costs you 20 bucks for lunch in America?
Expensive lunch.
You know, I actually got taken out to lunch by Valve at one point. And when I was there to do my thing, and they like it's every lunchtime, it's like, let's go out for lunch. And I'm just like, all right. So we're like a bunch of guys walking around with like our nerdy little t-shirts on, just like, you know, what's going on? And then like there's this like five-star restaurant right next to like the Valve offices.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, we just walk in, and you're like people in like business suits and everything else.
Uh-huh,
just like
briefcases, lawyers, judges.
It's like, this is a place where you actually have 12 bits of cutlery per person. And you're like... holy Hannah, what the hell are we doing in here?
You guys are just wearing t-shirts.
And then like the maitre d' walked up to us and just like, ah, oh, Valve. Just like walk over here. It's just like, would you like a wine tonight? And I'm just like, dude, like, what are we wearing? Like, I'll have a beer, thanks. Because, like, that was good times.
New generation, man.
That was good times. And as always, like, you don't say grace, you say thank you, Gabe. You think I'm joking?
Thank you, Gaben.
You think I'm actually joking about that, but that's actually what the Valve employees do. When they take you out for lunch and, like, if they pay on the Valve card, it's Nina. Thank you, Gabe. Let's talk about our game now, because okay. I'm glad you guys can enjoy the story, but we are here to actually cast. It's a dead rubber game. Neither team will advance from here, so this is like the reason why we're being a little more casual for our broadcast. Also, Cap and I haven't been in the same studio in a very, very long time.
Yeah, it's been a long time since we casted together.
Yeah, I've been gallivanting around Sweden doing stuff like
and
that.
And even when you were here, we were always split up because we had so much Radiant casting team. Going
yeah.
on.
That way we can always, like, sometimes we actually get to sleep properly and have, like, a normal rhythm. But yeah, let's look at our game, man. Let's look at our game. So, I'm going to ignore the bans because we're almost at the end of the picks. So, Doombringer, Mirana, Wraithkin, Bristleback coming in from WDL. Do we call them U5 or WDL?
We just call them U5.
I'm down for that.
That's what I've been calling
U5. U5? U5. We'll go German. U5.
No, let's not bring German into this cast. It's an English cast on Chinese teams. Let's not confuse things by throwing a little German in there.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so U5. So far, I've seen one Bristleback game today. Which wonderfully up against a Brewmaster. Absolutely superbly up against a Brewmaster. But it was a safe lane Bristleback farming up. In this game, I'm wondering with the Doombringer. We also had like a very greedy Doombringer that went with it. Like it was a jungle Doombringer from the very, very start. Also up against an Enchantress. But one big thing which I did notice, Enchantress, you're just able to put like this huge foot down in front of
10 seconds
in front of like any kind of jungling Doombringer. So I'm kind of hoping this is going to be a core Doombringer on the safe lane. Wraithkin, Mirana can actually go aggressive, even run the Doombringer in the middle lane up against the Invoker, and then Bristleback for an off lane. But something which is interesting to me as well, Lina, Sand King, and Enchantress. We're looking at either a core Lina or a core SK.
Yeah, this is certainly dream time. It plays into their style just because they didn't get the Brewmaster or the Nightstalker, so they don't get that natural aggression out of their mid. They're instead going to make up for that with an aggression of their presumably some sort of aggressive lane, whether they are actually going to be running this aggressively with the Sand King Lina and possibly the Enchantress joining them in the aggro try, or if this is going to be some sort of weird dual lanes. Either way, they're going to be running, I believe, a core Sand King. Now, core Lina is a possibility. I think it's especially with the buff to Aghanim's, I think that you can run a core position Lina, but not in this game. And the reason, because not in this game, U5 are running something that has been here throughout the meta for the last couple of months, is the triple tank lineup, is kind of what I refer to it. All three cores are going to be tanks of some sort. So you have the Doom, you have the Bristleback, and you notice the last ban from Dreamtime, they took away the DK. Right, you give U5 the DK, and they're kind of an unstoppable force. Mm-hmm. Your nuking damage from Sand King Lina will not be able to take that team fight. Like the epicenter, usually you get a good epicenter, you're like, oh, we won the team fight from there. Here, no. Especially if we get an early mech up on the Doom, it's going to be impossible. The Wraith King is another actual pretty tanky hero, and he's a support here.
It's true. That's true. I did like the last count to the Wraith King, though. And I remember I was preaching this one a long, long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I finally got to see it in game number one today, which was the Lion versus the Wraith King. Because you just drain him out. Obviously, Dreamtime doesn't have any kind of like last slot for the Lion to come in because they're already playing like a support core in this game. So they got to accept the fact that, like, you need to have yourself a hot, like a full-on carry kind of guy. And Phases of Void is one of probably the best ones they could have chosen here, because Bristleback, Wraith King, and Doombringer, they all can't function inside the Chronosphere, especially Bristleback. Bristleback's trying to keep his Quill Spray going into the heroes all the time. So if he's caught inside of that Chronosphere, correct me if I'm wrong, but will the Quills... Actually, how long does it take for the Quills to drop off?
The Quills can still go out, but they buffed the Quills recently, which is one of the big buffs to Bristleback. I believe it's now a 15-second 15 seconds.
Okay, so there's no way the Faces Void Chrono is going to last long enough for the quills to,
right,
to drop
off.
Right,
so you're still going to be able to keep the quills stacking. But I got to say, I think Bristleback belongs in the one position now. I think that with the recent buffs to his Warpath, it allows him to do an amazing amount of physical damage. I've been calling for him to be joining these triple tank lineups time and time again because he gives the one thing that oftentimes you're lacking in triple tank lineups is a lot of pushing power. Normally, when you run the triple tanks, one of them is going to be the Dragonite. But if you don't get the Dragonite, where's your pushing power really come from? You don't have that much physical damage coming from those. Bristleback is an incredibly good pusher, though, because of the changes to his Warpath. He builds up in damage very early on, and I have no idea why I loaded faster than you into the game.
I think it's because I was DCing at one point, so I'm hoping that doesn't...
Yeah, I think you might have to disconnect, reconnect, because I'm already... I've already got the heroes moving out.
All
right. U5, they're going to be running an invasion into the enemy jungle.
All right, so we're doing our wonderful. Hey, hang on. Whew! I'm glad that warning message pops up now.
Oh, did you accidentally hit the leave?
I hit the leave game button. And I'm just like,
Yeah, you would have had to. So U5 doing something really interesting here. They're running an invasion into the jungle, and they also smoke up in the process. So they actually are looking for some sort of pickoff here, and they might just find Dreamy U.
Oh, what a time to come back in again. With the Hellfire Blast, the arrow as well, and the combination, they've got him. U5 off to a perfect start. The Enchantress going down inside the jungle, which basically means that U5 can establish a nice aggressive portion here. And Sentry Ward... this one will only block up this camp. I've seen this time and time again. I haven't seen a single team that's planted a ward there that's blocked up both camps. At all. Ever. It just doesn't work. But they hide it in the trees anyway. And they're just going to back themselves up. So we get safe lane. You're going to get that. It is actually going to be La Tula.
Excellent.
Will be the Bristleback. Have you actually tried to do this one as well?
No. I've been calling him AAA.
Yeah, AAA 1-2-3.
Right? I just call him AAA. As far as the Chinese names go, I just call them by the hero name, man.
I'm gonna call that guy. So we got Doom 2, Old Chicken. Okay, now that one's just too easy. And then we have the Wraith King. The Wraith King. That works. The DT guys are a hell of a lot easier, but the DT guys are also mixing up their lanes again, too. So we've actually got a Faces Void in the middle lane going up against the Viper. Backtrack is his first ability. Now up on top lane, you got Injolai taking up the Sand King with a supporting Lina here. Now together, they can actually do a decent combination. Unfortunately, it's like a level 1 Burrow Strike into a Light Strike Array, but it's still a double stun. And U5, they're already moving up to do something about this. Hellfire Blast has to go into Super because of that. Like a Burrow Strike away and the Creep Wave coming up. It had to go into the Lina there. Now they just turn themselves around. Burrow Strike was used offensively, but the Light Strike Array connects into the Mirana. So she's forced to back up as well here. And our final lanes, which will be the bottom lane, which is XDD, taking the Exort Invoker, while Enchantress is going to be harassing the Doombringer inside the jungle. He does not really have enough life points to survive this one. In fact, Sunstrike's going to come in, hit him perfectly. There's no Cold Snap, but the base damage with the Shatter Blast, Hellfire Blast, actually going to keep the Doombringer alive long enough. Yeah, he'll be okay through this one, but he'll have to pop off the salve directly or go back to base. Considering he's got no mana, may as well walk back to base.
Yeah, a little bit of silly play there. Him trying to just go through the jungle like that completely blind just made no sense. Like, the best possible situation, you get to your lane a little bit faster. The worst possible situation, you die. You know, it's not worth the risk. So I have no idea what he's doing there, but I gotta say, Toby, I love it when the lanes actually pan out, like I'm calling it. So we have a one position Bristleback. We're still gonna be running this aggressive lane from Dreamtime. I wasn't sure whether or not the Enchantress was gonna be joining them with the aggro dual lane and make it sort of this pseudo tri lane. They can't be as aggressive without the Enchantress, but at the same time, if the Enchantress is able to put a lot of pressure on the two solo lanes, they can play themselves just defensively enough and beautiful. Like in July, every single time, I can't believe how quickly he was able to get off that Burrow Strike from the invisible Wraith King when he attempted that first stun. That was such a beautiful, quick reaction by him.
Something I found interesting though is like Sandstorm will disjoint the stun. Mm-hmm. But it looks like Burrow Strike didn't, because he still got hit by it. Even though his Burrow Strike timing, it came after the projectile was in the air. Like that was the only thing for me. Like I looked at that going, I thought you could actually dodge stuns with your Burrow Strike.
Yeah, you should be able to. I'm not sure entirely. It all comes down to the mechanics of the certain missile, and I remember I looked into this a long, long time ago. Back in Dota 1, every single ability was based off basically two different stunts.
Oh, top lane. Injuliai is going at this one. Wraith King I always want to call it Sacred Fire, but it's Dragon Slave. I think there's actually a thing called Sacred Fire inside of Dota. Ice Frog, idea created. But kill up on the top lane. So they're able to bring down the Wraith King with some just nice range DPS.
Yeah, they need to be paying attention, a little bit better attention to, just because it's a dual lane, it's a really powerful dual lane. Like, the Enchantress honestly didn't add much to that combination. If the Wraith King was still in that same position without the Enchantress, he would have lived, but he still would have been brought really, really low. So it's just him underestimating the power of the Sand King Lina combination. That is a triple nuke, double stun tri-lane. That is an incredible amount of power to lay down on one person. Any other support besides a Wraith King would actually die from just that combination. Just thankfully, Wraith King is naturally tanky, but the Enchantress now going to be making her play into the enemy jungle. Her jungle was a little bit blocked out, but this now allows her to be able to play aggressively between not only the defensive tri-lane, but also get around behind this mid lane, which it's doubtful you're ever going to be able to gank up the Viper truly, but just the added pressure, right? The psychological presence of there could be an Enchantress coming after me.
Varastry is going to go into the Mirana. The Sunstry is going to connect as well, and with a Slave over the top from Super, able to get himself a kill. And the Bristleback is forced back here while the Wraith King is trying to man fight underneath the Sentry Wall, but in July, even as a Sand King with three quills in his back, he was just tanking up every bit of damage that Wraith King was doing. And now it's 3-1 on the board in Dreamtime. They're just forcing the issues so well on the top. Oh, look at that. Like, just one range creep, man. One range creep. Dreamy, you left it for in July. So now they actually have Arcane Boots as well, fueling the top lane.
Yeah, this is something that I noticed before, is that U5 struggle a little bit in the laning phase, while Dreamtime, they're the exact opposite. They're a Chinese team that excels at being able to get the advantage in the early laning phase, and it goes to show, like, yeah. U5.
He's gonna leap up right now. He's slowing down Viper. The second he hit level 6, he's now trying to zone out Old Chicken. Sorry, yeah. Back to your point. I was waiting for the kill. I was waiting for this level 1 Chrono.
It's highly unlikely he's going to be able to get the kill, even with a Sunstrike over the top. Old Chicken, thanks to Corrosive Skin, not only you have the magic resistance, but also the attack speed slow. So it's unlikely Faceless Void by himself is going to be able to get that kill. They're going to need the Enchantress to make that rotation over if they have a hope of being able to kill the Viper. Honestly, I don't think it's worth the effort. If you're still farming well on the Faceless Void and he's 26
Cold snap. There's a lot of support coming to bottom lane. The Troll Trap from the Doombringer, because he had that troll inside of him. The Sunstrike's going to come down. It's just going to split the damage up between the three heroes, and Invoker is now dead in the Tree of Lion. While up on the top lane, they're diving on the Bristleback. Underneath the Tier 1 tower, Bristleback keeps his back turn, but it's just not enough. Enchantress, get rid of that tower aggro. Bristleback will be awarded the kill, but doesn't get the experience for it. But it will be a 2-for-1 trade-off. While Void, now he will actually commit towards the middle lane. So Old Chicken, he gets the Chrono off on him, able to get the kill off, and Wraith King arrives just too late. So makes actually a 2-for-2 trade, but well worth it, and in favor of DT.
Yeah, I think Dreamtime's whole entire lineup, I was a little bit concerned about the whole Sand King Lina going up against this, like, very tanky lineup, fearing that their power wouldn't be enough going into the mid game. But one of the downsides of this sort of triple tank lineup is you often come away with a little bit weak of a laning phase. Heroes like Doom, heroes like Dragonite don't often give you a lot of killing power. In the laning phase, you just kind of have to sit back and survive. Well, Dreamtime, if they take an early laning advantage like this, the mid-game power of U5 won't matter.
Barrowstrike, Lightstrike Array follow-up, and Sunstrike combining up together. The Bristleback damage, I don't think that's going to be enough to finish that Lina. Oh, 4 life points. Stickchart just kept him alive. Now, the Doom has gone off here on Super. Super will die here. It's just the question if he gets denied or not. He should almost turn back into this one because he cannot survive. Stickchart is available. Yeah, he turns to be denied. The Sandstorm also available, and without the Scorched Earth, Injuline knows he's just going to basically evade. Sentry Ward, Burrow strikes back through the two of them. They actually have no detection on him. So Injuline moves inside the tree line and will be okay.
Yeah, and look at him. He already had the Arcane Boots, has another 1,000 gold on top of that, so that's going to be a really fast Blink Dagger. This Blink Dagger is way ahead of time where it should be. Like, if you were actually farming up the jungle fully...
I'm doing my disconnect reconnect back in again. It's only just started. China, please explain.
If you were full-time committed to jungling on a Sand King, you could pick up a 9.5-minute Blink Dagger. Here, the Sand King just, like, he hasn't spent any time jungling whatsoever. They're doing so well in the laning phase, he could probably pick up a Blink Dagger by the 10 minutes. Then it's way too quick. Sand King should be punished for his level 1 to level 3 timing. Like, he shouldn't actually be rewarded with all these kills. Just U5 played it way too aggressively, assuming that they had an advantage because it was 3v2. But if you play a little bit too loose and fast with your positioning, like the Wraith King did, and you get caught once like that, that's going to turn into a big advantage because the dual lane is already getting an experience advantage on you because they're only splitting the experience between two heroes. So they're going to pick up level 3 and level 5 faster than you will. If you get them hero kills on top of it, it makes it just that much worse. Mm-hmm.
I'm still looking at my wonderful PLs.
Enjoying your PLs. Well, we're going to have a rotation in the top lane. In July, he's going to be able to land the Burrow Strike. And again, the same combination time and time again. They land both abilities from the Lina off of the Burrow Strike and the Sand Strike on top of it as well. So they always have enough nuking damage. Super's going to be chased down at the same time. Laguna Blade going to go onto the Doom that will be able to get off the Epicenter just in time from In July, but is only able to get the kill on the Marauder, and now he's going to be chased down by Doom, and with no way to be able to deny himself, it should be a quick, easy kill. He does have a nice little juke and maneuvers here, but I think he's still going to take out. It's going to be close, 11 health. Doom still gets the right click, though. Double kill for him. So Doom is at least making the right rotations across the map, being able to put in pressure where his tri-lane clearly failed. But overall, it's still Dreamtime taking the bigger advantage here because now Air, well, he's going to land the Chronosphere onto the Viper, the Sunstrike follow-up, and they should have enough nuking damage with DreamU joining Air with the right clicks just enough, just like last time. And how are you still not connected?
It didn't let me connect in the first time. I have to reconnect in the second time.
I kept looking over and expecting
don't
you
worry,
to be
people.
Like...
We're now moving ourselves into being Join Dota Radio. Yeah. Coming
it's
to you live
audio
with
cast.
Capital as your caster and play-by-play action man.
I remember those days when I would actually download the MP3 files and they would start, we're going to start this at 5 seconds in, 3, 2, 1, play. That's some nostalgia for you.
Yeah.
For people, did you ever have to do those?
I was a man who was around the only Dota 2 English cast that did it back in those days. So yes, I do remember.
Yeah,
those.
I just never listened.
I was
to
the one
of
creating
them. Cast.
Yeah, you never listened to me, man.
I
Cold snap on him right now. The arrow's gonna miss on In July. And XDD, he's just trying to kill Viper from range, but he cannot do so. Did you listen to me? You never listened to me, man.
No. I watched your cast. I just never remember listening to an audio cast of yours. I watched the video cast.
Yeah, I was doing audio casting a long time ago. Back when Garena actually cared about Dota.
Toby.
Arrow's coming in towards middle lane right now. That's well off target. And with a TP towards the front lines, Void doesn't have Chrono available. And let's use the Lifestriker Ray to keep the Bristle back in position. And looks like Alpha Wolf will now be consumed up by the Doombringer. So how we're actually looking is we get ourselves back into the game and everyone is able to watch it again. So about 5,000 gold, about 3,500 worth of experience or so. Key items, Enchantress building into Aghanim Scepter, Invoker's running hand of Midas, surprise for Exort. And we're getting a Mask of Madness coming in right now for Faceless Void. Yeah, there is. Mask of Madness in for Faceless Void. That Enchantress and Lina, they're actually doing pretty damn good for their farm. Same with the SK. Like, there's a lot of arcane boost between them. And In July's almost got himself a Blink Dagger on top of this.
In July's in a very precarious position here because he doesn't want to be just sitting there sandstorming up against a Bristleback because he do still take the Quill Spray damage. And the big problem here for this is that Air now has killing power where Viper no longer has his pushing power. Like, he still does not have his mech. This whole entire lineup depends on them being able to get their basic items in lane.
The Doom is going to come out right now. Who's going to cast the Doom on? He can go on the Enchantress, but he's actually going to do it on the Faceless Void. Now, Faceless Void can actually live through this one. Where the Lina puts down sentry wards because the Moonlight Shadow was protecting him. So they see the Mirana leap up here. The arrow well off target. Lifestrike Array, Slave as well. Does a lot of damage there to the Mirana. The last stack from the Doombringer will be able to reach that Lina and bring her down. But more support's coming back. Now Air, he's thinking about leaping back anyway because he tanked up the entire Doom level 1 ultimate. And while all this is going on, Invoker is still pushing out the tier 2 tower in the bottom lane. And you got SK who's just farming up the top lane and has purchased his Blink Dagger. So, what do they get? They get a Lina for losing a tier 2 tower.
Yeah, this is terrible. Well, actually, Bristleback's going to go down as well. Full Epicenter being used. This is the problem. Dreamtime got their mid-game items before U5 did. And that should not happen considering the fact you had a Viper versus a Faceless Void. Somehow, Faceless Void gets his Mask of Madness before you get your mech. You have the Sand King, who's picked up his Blink Dagger. Like, their whole entire combination for the mid-game is Chronosphere into Sunstrike into Blink Epicenter combination.
Yep.
Right? That's their whole entire combination. You five still don't have theirs, which is basically Mech, Reincarnation, maybe Doom picks up a quick Blink Dagger, but more likely he goes for more the passive, like, drums build and just goes pure stats. All they needed was stat items and a mech, and they could have just five-man into Dreamtime and should have been able to win all those early team fights and just taken tower after tower. And Dreamtime should have been forced to basically dodge them all the time and continue farming up their items like Blink. But they're so far ahead at this point in time that they can actually beat the mid-game of U5, and they clearly have some very strong late-game as well.
Arrow's called out the Enchantress right now. That Untouchable makes it really difficult to actually finish the kill, however. And Air's got a choice right now. He can just Chrono in, which he will do so. Gets that old chicken. Laguna Blade will help him to get the quick kill and then move over to the Wraith King. Now, he's got enough mana that Ankh will be able to trigger off. But there's already two heroes down for U5, and they come back up again. The SK actually getting doomed up. That Blink Dagger from Doombringer already kicking into play. But they did get the kill over on the Wraith King, and the battle still's going. Air trying to backtrack out. Actually, backtracked out the quill damage as well as the attack. So they move down to someone else, which is easier to kill. And that's going to be the Lina. She can't run away from this one. Level death from the Doombringer will then trigger. So they're able to get themselves some extra follow-up kills.
Very smart decision there. Very smart disengage by Dreamtime. You notice they had three heroes in that team fight left at the end. They all went separate directions because they already had quite a high number of quill stacks on every single one of them. They were getting into that danger zone where every single stack was going to be doing 200, 300 damage. So they split themselves off in three different directions. Bristleback could only choose one kill, so he went for the Lina, the easiest of the three.
Yeah. I'm actually kind of surprised like Bristleback doesn't become the primary target. Like, you look at it and go, okay, Bristleback is still going to be your highest DPSer. Yeah, I think even Doombringer was kind of like overshadowed during that game, during that fight too. Like, he jumped in and his control of the SK was perfect. If SK, speaking of which, Invoker and SK get their revenge, and they may even get a little bit more if that Mirana arrow looks like it connected over towards the Lina. But to bring down that Doombringer, like, to bring down that Bristleback at the very, very start, it wouldn't take that much committal to do so. And then you don't have that DPS. Mirana doesn't have DPS, Wraith King doesn't. Viper is still short of a mech, so he can't survive long enough. And the Doombringer is a little bit of control. That's it.
Yeah, I think you will see the Faceless Void. Just because the Bristleback wasn't there in the beginning of the fight, it meant that Air didn't go for that Chronosphere. But I think that if he sees the opportunity to lock down the Bristleback when he's facing towards his team, he will take that opportunity every single time, because that means they can just blow him up with Laguna Blade, like, actually hitting his face rather than his back. You have the Sunstrike over the top. Like, they do have enough nuking power to be able to take down that Bristleback. And you're right, once he's dead, there's just not enough fighting power for U5. The problem is that the Bristleback's a little bit tanky.
Burrow, they go straight into the Viper. The Centaur was right on top of two, and now the Chrono catching out three heroes. The SK's caught on the edge of this, however, but he should be okay with the Meteorite dropping down. It's burning up all of U5. It's currently 3-for-1, but it's about to become like 5-for-1. If they can chase him down, Blink Burrow Strike in there to Latula. And Air, well, he's currently doomed up, so he's out of the fight, but Lina is staying right on the tail of that Doombringer. But cannot have enough damage. He's already used his Laguna Blade. So it looks like they'll just take the tower as well as the three kills for the one.
Yeah, with the Blink Dagger pickup, I think it was smart by the Doom, but they can't afford to be initiated on. Like, every single time Doom's first target should be him blinking on the Faceless Void before Faceless Void leaps on them and gets the Chronosphere. If they can take away the Chronosphere, they've got themselves a chance. Just a chance of being able to win the team fight. But honestly, like, Faceless Void, just because you consider him a hard carry does not mean he's not a very effective mid-game carry. And I'm glad to see he's coming back. I think he deserves a lot more time in the spotlight because of his buffs that he's received.
Wraith King's in a little bit of trouble right now. They can't trigger off his ultimate because Laguna Blade's still on cooldown. And in July, a dust will be popped off. So they're able to find Tim. Super trying to run himself out of this one. He does have a Light Strike array, but he's going to cop a 5-second arrow. So with that, both the SK as well as Lina are picked up on the bottom lane. And that's probably just a little bit too... Or, like, you got a lot of confidence in this game already, Dreamtime. Their combinations are working nicely, and they thought maybe they could give it a crack on bottom. But U5 brought a lot of support to that fight.
Yeah, that was just them playing over-aggressive. But that tends to happen when you are so far ahead and you've spread yourselves out really thin. Because even when you do get picked off in those sort of scenarios, which they do happen sometimes, you play over aggressive, you get picked off, you lose a couple of heroes, Dreamtime are still getting the better end of the deal because they have three different heroes who are solo farming right now. The Enchantress in the jungle almost has her ags, the Invoker in the mid lane, and Faceless Void at top as well as the
Void
jungle.
Void has his ags too. It's coming out in the courier right now. So you got ags on him, level 3 Necrobook on the Invoker. Reminder, we're only 18 minutes into this game too. And then even SK, like with his death, you got Blink Dagger and 4 stuff over on him.
This is one of the rare games that I'm going to say that Sand King should be building into an Aghanim's as one of his first damage dealing items, not a Veil of Discord, because of the fact that Faceless Void got his Aghanim's. So if you can actually, with the Aghanim's upgrade at level 16, Sand King's ultimate goes down to 80 seconds. So you can actually time every single Chronosphere has an epicenter to go with it as well.
Explain this to me, China. How is our co-caster PC having a flawless connection in when it's on exactly the same internet line as our other one?
You know, I did not have... I had to disconnect, reconnect like 2 times during the Chinese qualifier.
Really?
Yeah, I had 0 issues.
See, I had no problems in game number 1 today. Game number 1 today was absolutely fine.
So you talk about me coming into the studio and somehow breaking things. I think you break the internet.
Possibly.
You break the internet.
I don't break internet, man. I'm just thinking in future Chinese games, I'm going to hardwire that computer to also come into the vision mixer. Mm. So that way we have a plan B. We have 2 computers. One of them will show it.
Before 20 minutes. I didn't even realize. I wasn't looking at the clock. I didn't realize we were still before the 20-minute mark. For him to have a Mask of Madness and an Ags is an insane amount of farm. Like, when you're talking about people hitting the 10K mark at this point.
Oh, that Doom's already gone off right now. They're chasing down In July again. And In July is going to be the sacrifice here. Like, they'll let him die because they're going in for Roshan instead. So they're going to get Negus Maul on the back of this Invoker. And, well, Yuffie have no idea what's going on. And DT are very much aware of this because they've already put down 2 Sentry Wards around the pit. So it's just a very simple jump him, take it out. If they decide to fight us, then Faceless Void would just chrono and kill you.
A small nerdy thing about, it's just a nerdy support thing, but look at the positioning of that counter ward. What it reveals is that warding spot and this warding spot. So it's actually a really effective counter ward that he placed there. I like it a lot.
You can geek yourself out in that one.
Hey man, I'm a support player by nature. Oh,
Void, jump in. And now I got Bristle back. He's outside of the base. Doombring will jump in. He actually used the Hoofstomp over on 2 heroes. So Super was never able to follow up directly into the damage. He does still have Laguna Blade, but now they're going to use Moonlight Shadow. The Sentry Wall is down for the Dire side, and they don't have any from the Radiant side, so they cannot see him. But Light Strike Array is able to hit on the Doombringer, and they just go. Well, they get through the Aegis Immortal. Wraith King ulti will also trigger off right now on Doombringer. He's in pretty deep. The arrow tanked up by air, but in comes SK with the Epicenter. 4 stars through the Doombringer's death, and then into the main fight. The Invoker still has gone down, but Void staying in the front line still, and Dreamy Yu, he just keeps blowing out these impetuses. There's so much pure damage coming the way of U5, but U5 are still repelling Dreamtime. Now he's going to actually get the kill on the Mirana. The arrow will hit his point blank range. He's out of mana, but he's going to try and have a crack here at the Bristleback. Yeah, I don't think he can't get the kill here. They back themselves up, and U5 they didn't have to buy... Actually, they bought back the Doombringer for that one.
Yeah, Doom was forced to buy back, and they also used the Reincarnation from the Wraith King, which is a level 1 ultimate, so that's a long cooldown. But in general, I think that was just Dreamtime seeing the Bristleback out there and going, we can kill him, because that's the target we want to focus early on. Now the Bristleback's a little bit too tanky. Like, once he finished up his Vanguard, you got to think twice about trying to go on him. After he finished up his Sage, as well as put just a plain cloak on as well, they can't actually kill him during the time of the Chronosphere. So that was, I think, a poor idea for them to try and isolate the Bristleback in that sort of scenario. And it also set up U5 really well to counter-initiate. You saw the Doom had a beautiful hoof stomp and also was able to follow that up with an arrow as well. Mirana played that beautifully. She landed like 3 or 4 different arrows in the team fight. So all of U5 playing the actual team fight engagements really well. It's just because they suffered so badly in the laning phase that they are unlikely to be able to come back from here. But never know. Dreamtime, they have a couple of more bad team fights like that, and they're going to start giving up map control. And once you start giving up map control to this team, U5 can spread themselves out a little bit more. They've got a 3-core, potentially even 4-core lineup, even though none of them are strong hard carries. they can go into late game decently well just because they have everybody who has room for growth. What I love about this lineup, by the way, is the alacrity from the Invoker. Normally, it's not an ability you think of when you go for a Quas Wex, or not a Quas Wex, and an Exhort Invoker. But because you just get one level of Wex and you do get the alacrity, you get a pure amount of damage from it. When you put it on the Faceless Void, who's already has all the attack speed he needs because of Mask of Madness, it's actually a huge buff to him.
That's true. That's true.
Many people just think about Alacrity as like, oh, all the attack speed, all the attack speed. But if you have high levels of Exhort like that, it actually gives you a really good amount of base damage.
There's also a max Exhort Invoker. And it looks like U5 is trying to set a bit of a trap for him. I thought for a moment DT was going to force themselves through the top lane and then have U5 completely out of position. The U5 smoke to come down here to the bottom lane, maybe expecting they are being visible somewhere on the lane, but they're not. Like, this is Necro units as well as Forge Spirits just pushing out the bottom lane now that Doombringer finally reveals himself.
So this has been a trend I've found in Chinese Dota. The couple of Faceless Void games that I've been watching, they seem to tend for an item that is very rare to see as a first damage-dealing item, which is the Crystallis Daedalus. Very rare to see because oftentimes Crystallis Daedalus don't really become... they're more effective, obviously, the more damage you have.
Yeah.
So as your first damage-dealing item, they're not the most effective items in the world.
At the same point, though, like, you wouldn't want to build into the current like Mjolnir build because now it's even more expensive.
Mm-hmm. That's true. I still value the Maelstrom quite a bit, but at the same time, Crystallis does give you pure physical damage, which is important at this point in time. Oftentimes, heroes are still lacking in armor. They haven't really built into that quite yet. They oftentimes focus on magic armor over regular armor at this point. And then on top of that, just being able to have the opportunity, if you do get one or two crits within that Chronosphere mixed in with one or two bashes, you probably will be able to finish off one hero at least during that Chronosphere. So,
You've already got the damage from the Alacrity, as you were saying before, so the whole synergy works perfectly.
Yeah, I suppose with Alacrity, it gives it a lot more viability as a first item pickup.
Yeah. And the Enchantress now is going to be pumping out so much damage as well. Like, you talk about the damage coming out from the Faceless Void. The person who's doing the most amount of damage during these team fights now is the Enchantress. She built a Mask of Madness. It's coming out in the Courier now, so when it arrives, you can have a pure stream of Impetus. This is like an easy way to kill off anyone you could find. And now also with a Veil of Discord being afforded up by the Sand King, they're going to look for a nice backward area where they can just throw in a good epicenter. The arrow's going to fly in. It's only hitting on Necrobooks. At this point, U5 are just waiting for DT to come high ground.
Yeah, because one of the big things that is... I talked about it earlier, the downfalls of the triple tank lineups is oftentimes you don't have a whole lot of killing power in the laning phase. One of the other big downsides, you oftentimes don't have very good initiation, and that's what something Dreamtime excel at with their lineup. They've got the Faceless Void with the big Chronosphere, that's one of the best initiators you could possibly have, and then the follow-up Sand King and his Blink Burrow Strike. So what Dreamtime take a look at their U5's lineup and they go, okay, we know we can always hit the perfect initiation because we're never going to be initiated on. Like, that's all entirely up to the Doom. And Doom is a very hard hero to initiate well on because it's just you blinking in and dooming somebody. You don't actually have many abilities to hold people there to actually force them to take the team fight. So if a Doom blinks in and he just dooms somebody, you can just right away disengage. Just back yourself out. And there's not enough holding abilities, there's not enough initiation from U5 to force you to take that fight.
Chrono, bottom lane, coming up for the Viper. The top lane's also trying to initiate, but the Viper's already gone down. Up on the top lane in July, hiding in the tree lines. Now, Burrow strikes himself to the other side of the trees and then just tries to keep running in. Sandstorms in and then blinks into the deeper into the tree line. And Doombringer can follow him in right now. In fact, follows him exactly in position. Gets the Doom off, so in July's locked in the corner for now. And he will go down inside the tree line.
They're tired of that slippery little bugger. Just throw out the whole entire Doom. In the meantime, they still lost the Viper. They're still being pushed in heavily. Their tier 3 tower is going to go down soon. Like, they were never supposed to be in this position. They were never supposed to be pushed in on like this. Because they have no way to be able to stop this slow push from Dreamtime.
They're breaching high ground now, by the way, people. So while I'm forced to reconnect again, they're actually bringing down... They've already got the tier 3 tower, and they're going to bring down the melee racks as well. So this is now like, are they going to get anyone on the way out? Void, he's actually going to jump himself in and perfectly chrono the Bristle back. Now Wraithkin's gone down, so everyone's pretty well slowed up, but there will be the Deafening Blast just pushing everyone back again, trying to buy space here for Dreamtime. They're going to lose some heroes on the way out of here. They did bring down the Melee Racks at least for this, but they lose what? SK as well as Lina. Worth it.
Yeah, not bad at all. For Dreamtime, they did a very good job cutting their losses. At that scenario, like, everyone just kind of abandoned the two heroes who got caught. It's fine. They lose those two heroes. They still get themselves a big advantage. The worst possible thing you can do in this sort of scenario is get greedy and try and save your heroes and end up losing a whole entire team fight that allows you five to push back out and take map control. With three heroes alive, you can still keep pressures. You can see they're probably angling themselves for a pickoff here at this bottom lane. If Doom pushes out too far and tries to get too much map control, Air's going to come in with that Chronosphere, hold that hero in place. He's going to beat him down as well as the Enchantress joining him. Oh, well, you're still frozen up. We do have Dreamy.
I got in, but I was having 1 frame a second. That was all I was getting.
Well, Dreamy U was actually initiated on by the Viper, but because he's got the maxed out Untouchable, he's fine. There are no BKBs on the side of U5, which actually makes the Untouchable build from Enchantress really good.
Yeah. It's almost at the full protection. You think like you put yourself at risk triggering off your own Mask of Madness, but then you realize what damage can actually hit me. Mm-hmm. And the answer is little to nothing.
So we have a Shiva's being finished up by the Doom. We've got a couple other Halberd as well as a Blade Mail was picked up by the Bristleback. And the Viper is still trying to get towards Aghanim's, but he had like a 20-minute mech. He's now going to have like a 35-minute Aghanim's. He's so far behind in farm. You look at his net worth, he's actually fourth lowest on the board. And that's what happens when a Viper loses his laning phase, because he's very much like an OD where he shouldn't lose his laning phase and he has no recovery if he does.
It was kind of a crazy lane for him to be in though. Like it was Viper up against a faceless Void.
Yeah.
And I remember I kept looking at it, and just even with like one level up in backtrack, the Void was actually avoiding so many of the attacks coming in from the Viper. It's like, I'm going to get the upper hand here. I'm going to get the upper. Wait, no, I can't because I keep missing every time. So harassment damage does little to nothing from the Viper in the early stages. And by that point, Void had already got enough farm as well as levels so that he was going to be okay. Because what are you also going to do? Slow up the Void? He just time walks himself away to safety. And because in July, now hello, bottom lane, Epicenter, Sunstrike, Veil of Discord. That didn't last long with Laguna Blade as well combining up. So the Doombringer's down for 70 seconds, and that is with no buyback. He's short by 700 gold. DT can now breach the bottom lane, and Air's coming to help him out.
I keep looking at their lineup and going, who's grabbing the pipe? Like, a pipe is an essential item.
Burrow Strike going to go on the Wraith King. There's impetus damage, though. It does bring down the Wraith King, so now his Ankh is also on cooldown for 160 seconds. Then Air into the ulti form. Who's he hitting on right now?
Beautiful okay. Halberd usage there from Mazala.
That's what it was. Burrow Strike through three heroes from in July. However, the impetus damage is still flying up, and it's enough damage to kill off the Wraith King. Unfortunately for Enchantress, she was tanking up the tower the entire time, and her sprites can't keep her alive. Even with the help coming from Invoker with the Meteorite, it wasn't enough. The gem was also dropped by the Wraith King when he went down. So they'll just be picked up here by the Viper. But they didn't want to go for that one fully anyway, because Roshan's up and running. And yeah. If you five come down to defend it, by the time they get here, it's already going to be too late.
Halberd was an excellent pickup for the Bristleback in this game. Like, normally you would pick it up anyways, a Bristleback. It's a great item for you to have in general. But up against the faceless Void, who is not dealing with a whole lot of magic damage, he's not going to build into a BKB, meaning you're always going to be able to disarm him.
So our chat trivia, Aghanim's up to 3 euros to finish it over more than 100 times in 6.81.
So Ancient Apparition is...
Yeah, 100%.
100%.
100% SAA.
We haven't seen enough Visage. Normally Visage would be a call, but we haven't actually seen enough Visage in this patch. He fell off rather heavily. So he's actually another one of those supports which always gets an Aghanim's, but we just haven't seen him enough. So Viper, I think, is going to be one of them. We've seen a lot of Viper. He's been rising in the pool quite heavily, and he always goes in Aghanim's, no matter what his build, whether it's a mech and picks up a BKB at some point. He usually always goes into
Blink Burrow. They found the Mirana. The impetus damage is just coming. He's able to disjoint it, though, with the leap away. But the Doombringer also on the front lines. Void push into the arrow. But again, like, more impetus and slowing him down. The sprites are going. Look at it. Just chasing in for the kill. They've already got the kill out on one. Viper's going down the bottom lane. Looks like InJuly Blink to Burrow Strike was able to help set up for that one. And now U5 can try and breach through the bottom lane. Now, we have our third mystery hero for the Agate Inceptor. But, man, I think you're right with the two you've got.
Doom has... He obviously has been picked up a lot, but...
For sometimes in China, they would do that. Hey!
Yeah, he doesn't always go for the Axe.
They're currently putting him up on stilts like a car. And that's going to be, the death of the Doombringer caught inside the faces for Chrono. With the, Veil of Discord, they just leap in here. This game is over. U5 has lost their entire team inside their base. The bottom rack's been taken out. The mid rack's been fully taken out as well. The question is, Dreamtime just try and finish it completely? And, the answer could be yes. They got the Bristle Pack outside the base. And Pettis damage. The Blade Mail is really hurting hard. With the Starfall damage from the Mirana, he's just going to get himself a kill here on InJuly, which is nice. Lightstrike and Raid, though, makes so we can't follow it in. 77 life points, and then the last attack in from the leader. Able to get the kill. Air is sticking with it for the moment. And, Ancient Apparition. She's the Brewmaster. How do we forget about him? Air's. Okay, up in the air. They can't chase the chicken in there. You can't chase chicken in there. You have the Aegis C model, which is nice. They force staff him out. That's one way to do it. GG is the call. The Brewmaster, man. That was the last one.
Yeah, I was going to say it's either Doom or Brewmaster, but I don't think Doom, you don't see Aghanims enough on him. While Brewmaster has been picked up as often as a Doom, and Aghanims is a must. So.
Yeah. Well, that's going to wrap up our games for today, and also wrap up Group A. As far as the matches go for the CEDIC New Star Tournament, of course, you can follow all the coverage, including the playoffs, right here on Joined.Red. We got more fun coming up as well on Joined.Red. Make sure you keep your eyes very much peeled to the channel. But we're back to do the Group 2 matches tomorrow. We start at 13 CEST. It's two best of one matches every single day for the next 3 days. So we'll have HGT versus Speed and also Happy Boys, as opposed to Sad Boys, going up against LGD CDEC. So those matches will be coming up tomorrow. I'll be your commentator for that one. Hopefully I'll be joined as well by a couple of other people, and we'll be having some fun here on the live stream. So in the meantime, thanks for watching. As Nahar says up on the screen, follow us over on Twitter, Facebook, and all that kind of jazz. And yeah, we'll see you guys tomorrow. I don't think have you got anything else you want to say to the peoples?
No, I've talked to them enough.
Awesome. Awesome. We still love you. All right. Farewell, peoples. We'll see you tomorrow.
Good night.